I'm using kerosene, or you can use diesel. They both pretty much the same grade, almost. Anyway, to help clean parts. Also using an electric toothbrush. I figure, hell, if it can work on people's dirty plaques in their mouth, it can work on this delicate part there. Reasons for me buying an actual commercial jet engine, and I went with a big one versus the small RC, because I'm like, hell, if you're going to spend close to the same price or a little bit more, why not go big? But anyway, you can pretty much see how these things are made and say, hey, I want more of this shit. So get yourself an old turbocharger wheel if you can't find one of these big ones. Now there's another one by the Garrett that comes close to this size. It's actually probably about, I'm gonna show you online. But anyway, it's almost close to this size, one of their biggest turbo. And it's probably expensive if you were trying to get one of these, but you can probably find a wheel off of eBay. Usually find parts on eBay like myself. But yeah, you could probably replicate some of this. I'm gonna actually attempt partial to cold section with 3D printing, you know, which doesn't have to deal with the heat part, and then, you know, build a metal casting or something. Definitely the rest of the parts will have to be heat resistance. I don't know, it's an idea. This was done, I think, last year, but yeah, it's 3D printed compressor. Now this particular one here, I seriously doubt can uphold any high spinning rotations. Probably will explode. It's very flimsy, but I wanted to test to see if I can 3D print one of these things. So probably will want a much stronger, like I said, nylon X or carbon fiber type filament. I don't know, I might make it to 30,000, 40,000 RPM. We have to test that, you know, see if we can handle that kind of spinning rotation. But look at that. Well, even haven't even gotten this. I just recently gotten this towards the end of, what was it, December, around December of 2021. Good Christmas gift to myself. And I don't even celebrate Christmas. So, it's possible, like I said, to make parts nowadays with, like I said, check this out, me looking into axial type compressor wheels and fans. Just seeing before I dedicate. Now, this is nylon, carbon fiber type. Pretty strong. This might be able to hold. Now, here's the thing about spinning these things. So what I found out, studying online, you can find a lot of things online, is that the smaller a wheel is, the less pressure, or what they call, anyway, it can handle the spinning, high rotational spin a lot better than a bigger wheel. You get what I'm saying? So, look at that, super speed. Y'all don't know they call me Superman too. But anyway, give it a try. You know, I know some of you guys out there are pretty smart. Willing to, you know, take a chance and do things even if it fails. You never know until you try. Some people just don't do it because they like, oh, I'm afraid it may not work. Well, how the hell would you know until you try?
6.6 pounds. Ooh, not bad for this engine. So I calculated, I added a few more pounds because it doesn't have its oil system and fuel system connected, which I gotta make that myself. But anyway, I figure let's round it off 50 pounds total weight of this engine, kicking out about maybe 290, 300. I just say 290 pounds of thrust divided by its weight, that comes to 5.8. That's a 5.8 ratio, weight ratio to thrust. Not bad, huh? So basically, it can do a payload of 240 pounds. I guess we gotta subtract fuel, how much that carries, how much fuel. But yeah, it can move a 200 pound man. So in the last video, I made mention of how to make my jet engines a lot more powerful. And as I made mention, compression, or more air and compression squeezed into the engine. So that usually takes trying to get another source of power, I guess, another compressor, more compressor. So I bought this off of eBay. This comes out of the Allison 250. And let me see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 axial stage and 1 centrifugal. So, or I can use that. Here's another one that came. This came off the Pitt and Whitney, Pat and Whitney, I'm saying it right, PT6. This is one of the type of impellers they have. There's another one. Give me a second. Okay, so this is another one for the PT6 Pat and Whitney. Two different kind of models. Just like this, they had an axial fans in front, feed into this, and these things spin and blow into the engine. And you know you're going to get some major powers out of these big boys. I hadn't had a time to clean this one up yet either. It would take a second turbine feeding from the... Here, let me show you what I'm talking about.
I'm back. Phone calls. This one. Yeah. Suck is pretty heavy. We probably wouldn't want these to spin no more than 20,000, 30,000 RPM. Like I was saying, based on how big an impeller is, you can't go but so fast. Otherwise, you run into some major problem. Smaller the turbine or compressor, the faster they can go. If you ever notice those small, tiny turbochargers, they spin about 100,000 RPM, 2,000, depending on the size. But then, as you get much bigger, like I think I read, these axle part here get up to about 30,000, maybe 40,000. Or runs into problem due to the stress level on the blades and all. But you know, it won't fly apart. I think it can handle it. Might actually make it to 50. I gotta reread again, but I'm not very good at explaining this stuff, but giving it a try. So more air, more compression, more power. So I'm not sure how much piece it all together. Here's an interesting turbine. This one is that real thick type one.
is to probably work on that turbonique type of concept I was showing in the last video, where the gas impings on these, giving you a lot of more strength to torque. And yes, jet engine do produce a lot of torque. You hear these things run up and close. If you never heard them, you can feel the energy just standing near it. It's kind of scary. There's a lot of power in these things. I got this. It's a fan from a backpack blower. I believe it's aluminum. I ordered it on eBay. I think it came from those, what you call those, Stelts? Can't even pronunciate the backpack blowers. But they actually kicked out a lot of air, a lot of power. For you guys working on a budget, can't afford to find these fancier things, you might want to look into just a simple fan to blow more air into your compressor. These things normally spin about 7,000 RPM on a backpack, produce all that power to blow leaves, almost blow a small child back if he was holding it. Yeah, I'm using a paint stripper for the hard to reach area. I figure, hell, if it's good enough to strip paint, it should be able to strip doggone gook. Titanium alloy. Restore it back to its naturalness a little bit. Not perfect. Looks good, don't it? Anything mechanical, jet engine, car engine, they all look pretty good. I mean, got that shine going to metal parts, engine parts.
Look how big that sucker is too. That almost 12 inches in diameter. You know there's going to be a lot of power air coming out of this thing if it ever ran.
This T62 cleaned out. It actually does polish well. It's kind of hard to reach in some of these areas back here. I'm trying to get this piece off. Having trouble getting this off so I can clean better back there. Might have to end up cutting this. But been doing a lot more research on the T62. I do believe this is the T6240 because they have these extra nozzle here. Like I said, there's exhaust air coming from the compressor, but it heats up from the combustion chamber. Yeah, get some of the heat from the combustion chamber, so you get a lot of hot exhaust air coming out of this thing and pushing out. Could be good for de-icing planes or whatever. I guess it's going in, or they've been in, because it is an APU unit for starting bigger engines. But because they work so well, these things, these engines have been used on small helicopters or experimental aircraft. Now, far as the fuel system, I'm still trying to figure all that out. It does have, from what I've been reading up, an evaporation system. But it had like two forms of a fuel system. You needed something initially to get it going. I think a separate evaporation heat exchanger before the fuel came out and entered to this these ports. I have no idea what these holes are below, trying to figure out the spark plug. But now, as much as I love these type of fancy commercial engines, I pretty much like mine a little bit more. For the fact, because I built it, I understand it more. Simplicity. I like simplicity. Mine actually has one fuel nozzle, fuel injector. It also has a vaporizing tube that I put in. A little bit of air mix in with the fuel coming down, going into the vaporizing tube and burning inside. This is my natural gas propane inlet to get it started. Quick burn spark plug. This thing reads how hot it is in there. Underneath, this is my oil outlet of the big turbocharger. Simple, you know, gravity, you know, drop down flow. At the top, we have oil inlet. Simple. Oil inlet, oil outlet. Of course, we know what this is, the intake, right? Intake, exhaust. Those who've seen my other videos see how these things blast some serious air in and out. Heats up the air in the combustion chamber, it expands, and boom, voila, it's blowing some serious air thrust. Simple engine. You know, I look at regular home-built turbocharger just like the old cars of the old days before all these computer electronic stuff that like cars have today. We can easily work on those old engines back, let's see, I guess, what, 1990 and below. I mean, it was, some of them were getting a little bit complex, beforehand, but the old original car engines, you know, we can work on those things. No problem. It was just simple. You have a carburetor or maybe a little fuel injection, but it was just simple. Now everything's controlled by computers and stuff. You need high-tech mechanics. So the cool thing that I read about fuel nozzles for jet engines, you can actually control the amount of... It saves a little bit more on fuel consumption. But also, like I said, you release a little bit more energy when you have droplets or so mixing in with that air versus vaporizing. And vaporizer gets the gas burning very quickly. But with these two, what I've understand for what I've seen with my engine is that it's very throttleable. APUs, they're not as throttleable. But what I've been reading, they have to run at almost near 100%, no less than 70-80%. So it runs, and it runs high, and I guess you got to have like a free turbine or some other source to really control speed up and down, gearboxes or so. I know this part connects to a gearbox of some sort, and rated at 6,000 RPM. Now this, actually, what I've read is spinning like at 61,000 RPM. Mine's supposed to max out at 70. I don't know what this Russian thing is capable of doing, not yet. Think it's one of their first experimental engine before the TJ 80s and 100 and above. So if it's saying it's a TE 100C, it might be like their TJ 100 if you look it up, which means it's, if it's the same thing as I think, it's rated at over 200, almost near 300 pounds of thrust. So that's not bad for an engine that weighs, 49 pounds. Let's look at that again. Okay, here's a scale. Tap it to get it going. Zero weight. I'm not going to get on there so you see how much I weigh. Okay, so I put it on there. Actually, it's 46.6 pounds. Not bad for this. Oh, that thing's gonna make a lot of noise when it gets high speed. Sweet. Take three. So me understanding my engine with its fuel nozzle and vaporizing tube and spark system, I'm gonna see if I can convert part of that knowledge into this engine and possibly maybe that engine. It's a little tricky. So me understanding the T62 a little bit more better on how it operates as far as its fuel system, definitely these are vaporizing, but we have to vaporize the fuel before it even gets to this part. So I don't know, I might create some type of heat exchanger that copper coiling. So it, I don't know, maybe even keep it going by having a coil down here and come out like how I did this engine when I was first building them. So we'll see. High temperature is like 1100 degrees. Same thing with my engine. When it gets to high speed, it's about 1000 to 1100. Because once it runs higher, the engine cools a little bit better. I may or may not open up the hose, like I said, on this one. I think I'm going to leave it as is so as not to mess anything up. It's design specs. I guess if I, like I said, needed to, probably saw some of this into a second combustion of some sort along with the gas here, the exit gas. This isn't designed for a thrust, I don't think, in any form. So just use it as a power turbine type unit, I guess. But anyway, I'm going to focus a bit more onto how my design is. I like how mine's actually flow a little bit more better. I understand it a lot more. Get my power turbine up and running. And we're going to see how to make something out of those. Okay. Up next, the power turbine. Can we make power? Yeah, I think so. Look at that. This is beautiful. I'm going to have to clean this one up. Let's go ahead and take a video of how it before look. And then, of course, an after. weighing in at 77 pounds. 77. Combine that with this 60, 70 pound total, I believe. Add that. Got about 140 pounds, I believe. Okay, I was wrong. 70.6 pounds for this thing. 62.2 pounds. 62.2 and 70.76 give us a grand total of 132.8, not including fuel pump and oil reserve tank. But I'm quite sure, add a few more things, we just may make it to 140 pound total engine. That is possibly kicking out about 100-150 horses. We'll see. That's still not bad. Jet engines kick out a lot of torque, and like I said, when this pup is up to high speed, it really, you can feel the energy coming from it. 50, 60, 70, 100 pound thrust can be achieved from this truck turbocharger, excuse me. But anyway, it's not bad for a home built. Let's start working on it. Alright, these are the items I'm going to be using to make the connection between the turbocharger or jet engines to the power turbine. This thing, couldn't find a V-clamp that fit this, so I'm going to have to weld this. Probably not the best idea, but I have no choice. Hate to enclose this off like that. But I guess I can always find or try to buy another one if I need to do something else with one of these. But for the love of science, I'm going to do it. So this is an old exhaust for the back of the turbocharger that we connect to that. In order for that to fit, I'm going to have to build it like that. So I have this 1/4 steel plate in this, and I also have a 16 gauge plate. Trying to determine which one would be best suited to make the wall for this. I can't even say things right when I'm trying to film. But anyway, you understand what I'm saying. This sucker here is hard to cut. I'm not sure my plasma cutter is strong enough to, hot enough to cut through 1/4. They say it's rated to do so. But I think I'm going to go with the 16 gauge. Maybe cut out two pieces and connect weld those together. It'd be easy to cut a hole in the middle too for that. Or for this to fit in the middle. So that should make it much stronger to hold up and connect these two all together. And the heat won't make it buckle as bad. So we'll go with the 16 gauge. Save this for later. Now, originally this 6-inch piping was supposed to be for another combustion chamber. I was going to design another combustion chamber for another turbocharger under here. Got two more in my storage area. Though the other two is much more brand new. This is an older model. But anyway, bought this two of these off of eBay. Professional combustion chamber, almost like the one is in, well, not quite like I made the one inside, but made one inside of here. It's my own design. But you ever want to learn how to do combustion chamber. Going to save up the money and buy one from somewhere. Even if you don't install it, at least get it, study it, and work things around from that. As you can see, this is more of a swirl type up here. You know, check out how they have the hose. These two big ass hoses are designed for piping for six other cans or more to run the fire from one combustion chamber to the next. This is connected in series, so usually there's a spark in one or two of the cans and the fire kind of disperse or travel through these little piping to start the other ones. I'm trying to get my words out. So, okay. So yeah, the combustion chamber was going to fit inside one of my can design. Fuel injectors fitting up in here. Injecting fuel. So I'm going to probably have to go out and buy another one because I'm about to cut this for the love of science for connecting my power turbine. As you can see, I'm not very good at plasma cutting. Wish I was an expert. Look at all that. That's why I kind of cut a little ways from when I did the marking, because I knew it was splatter and all that other nastiness. I can trim all this up later after I finish welding it to this pup here. To make sure I didn't cut too far inward, but I'd rather for it to overlap. February 6th on a Sunday in Atlanta. We finally completed, in a sense, a gas turbine engine. And it's a turbine engine, gas turbine engine, because it's a power unit. It's not run by thrust, but by traction. Well, it works. It's spinning just a tad bit. Of course, it's not going to spin very fast with that little bit of air coming through and hitting the compressor and the turbine and another turbine, the power turbine, which may spin a little fast, but not that fast. But this thing comes down to a 5-to-1 ratio. So, but I didn't videotape when I had the leaf blower just going through this section. It was kind of hard to hold this. It was torquing. It was definitely torquing after with just 4 pounds of thrust coming from a electric leaf blower. Of course, we know a turbojet would have much higher speed velocity air, hot air, with a lot more thrust going through. So if it was hard for 4 pounds of thrust for my hands to hold this when it was turning, I just can't imagine what happens with 50, 60, 70 pounds of thrust. It's going to be interesting. But if I can get the compression ratio in front and something else to get more air and more compression, we're going to have a lot more compressed gas coming through the system and out, and still probably has some residue of gas to do something with it, maybe. I'm still trying to figure out what the hell hit this thing and dented it. That's some pretty thick cast iron. That's somebody shot at the vehicle that it came out of. A bullet might have hit it. I don't know. Something hard, but it didn't damage anything else on this unit. You can't step to my throne. They ain't working like me. I did this on my own. You asking where we been, huh? I don't know where to begin, huh? All this dirt on my skin. I just came here to win. I'm more than a man, I'm a monster. Somebody call a pastor, doctor. I got a 6 cents for imposters. So now I'm coming for the whole roster.